Robert thinks this is a 3rd and 8 for the Bearcats. 3 of 11 on 3rd down. Lego fires, caught, the tight end, Adrian Robinson. Up near the 11, a 1st down for Cincinnati. That goes for 17 yards. Thought at some point, Ray, they'd get the tight end in the mix.
Right, and that always is a good thing for a young quarterback, letting throw to tight ends. And Lego, to me, don't move him around. He's been very inaccurate when he's moving to make the throws, but when he sits in the pocket, he's been pretty good.
Handed off, cut up field, Pete inside the 5, touchdown! 10-yard touchdown run, and the Bearcats have come back to reclaim the lead. Second touchdown game, touchdown of the game for Pete. 10 rushing touchdowns on the year.
Boy, he got a great block from Randy Martinez, the left guard. That's what opened that thing up.
Emiliano's point after. 21-17 Bearcats.
Here he is. Isaiah Pete finds a little seam, hits that crease, pops into the end zone, and Cincinnati has taken the lead.
Here, but can they hang on? That was only a 3.5-minute drive.
Seemed like 3.5 hours, didn't it?
And they converted 3 3rd downs on that drive. They were just 1 of 9 on 3rd downs prior to that possession. Austin eludes one tackler to the 25 and up to the 26-yard line. Adrian Whitty ran him down. Geno Smith, though, through all of this race, had a very good football game, going almost 300 yards passing.
Yeah, he's been outstanding today, doing the little things. You know, he's had a couple of balls dropped by his receivers, but he is really, I think, starting to master and fully understand the nuances of Dana Holgorsen's offense. He'll be back. He's just a junior. He should be back for a nice senior year next year.
1st down, Mountaineers from the 26. Give it to Sean Alston for the 30 for a gain of 4. We haven't seen much of Alston carrying the football today.
He's kind of a change of pace, a bigger back at 5'11", 2 1/4. And, boy, he had his breakout game in the snow against Rutgers. You know, he was one of the few guys who could really get some good speed up in that kind of weather and the bad traction.
They had 14 carries for a career-high 110 yards in that game. Across the middle, still on the move to midfield, Willie Milhouse. Milhouse's first catch of the game takes him into Cincinnati territory for 24 yards.
And they did an interesting thing. They released Sean Alston out of the backfield, and then he ends up being a blocker over here. See, Alston, he shows up in front of this thing to lead the way. Add a little more yardage to it for Milhouse.
1st down, Mountaineers at the 45 of Cincinnati. Alston again in the backfield. 3 receivers right. 1 left is Bailey, but it goes straight ahead. Inside the 45, tackled by Jordan Stepp. Here's the studio once again, and Robert Flores. Great games today. Thank you, Robert. 2nd down and 8. Smith to the far side, tipped, did he get it? No, almost intercepted. Couple of hands touched it. Drew Fry, the last to have an opportunity to pick it off. Cheatham was the one who deflected it initially for Cincinnati.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, Stedman Bailey does a nice job of breaking it up there, and then he reaches in and breaks it up again. That's a heck of a play by Bailey, protecting his quarterback. Breaks that one up and then sticks the arm out there and interferes and disrupts Fry.
3rd and 8. They need to get to the 35 for a 1st down. Mountaineers 3 of 12 on third down today. Smith being chased by Stewart. Keeps it alive, throws. And a catch for a first down at the 30 by Bailey.
All right, this is awesome by Geno Smith of keeping this thing alive and then just throwing a strike against your body. When you're running left and you throw it right on a dime into a tight spot like that, that's really good quarterbacking right there.
Gain 13, first down, Mountaineers at the 31. Cincinnati scored on their last possession to take their first lead since the first couple of minutes of the game, and Smith tackled for a loss. John Hughes, the nose guard, gets him. Fifth sack of the game for Cincinnati.
And that's one of those relentless effort sacks, which we, most of these sacks have been. See Hughes on the right side of your screen, just bull rushing, pushing his man Barclay back into the quarterback, falling off of that and hitting the quarterback.
Cincinnati's been top 10 in the nation in sacks this year. With five today, they're up to 31 on the season.
A lot of them are effort sacks coming late.
Out of the reach of Austin. Walter Stewart, the end, had the coverage.
Yeah, and they do different things with Walter Stewart. They put him in what they call the cheetah position right there, number 54, and you see him might have had his arm around Austin. I mean, you want to talk about an all-time mismatch. You got Austin, Tavon Austin, against a defensive lineman, and yet Stewart got it done.
Third and 15. They have Austin and Bailey to the left. The pass is completed at the 38-yard line. Austin, first down. Along the sideline, he did step out. They're going to mark him out at the 13. And another West Virginia first down. They convert by going 23 yards.
That's just a really bad angle by Chris Williams. You're going to see Chris Williams get beat to the sideline. He's got contained. Right there, you see him coming. He's got to take a much better angle.
That's McCartney, a few yards after the catch, up to the 10. Going to play with Austin where he stepped out.
Yeah, just a couple yards past the marker. Definitely a first down. Cincinnati rotating some guys in late.
Smith changing again. Hands it off. Bowie cuts it upfield inside the 5. See where they spot that to make it a first and goal.
Some good running there by Bowie. He's got some explosiveness. Another one of those true freshmen that rotate in for the Mountaineers at that tailback spot.
First and goal from the 2. Austin barrels ahead. Doesn't quite get in. Jordan Stepp, number 94, met him.
This is where West Virginia has struggled this year a little bit, being physical and getting it in the red zone.
Quick snap, and Austin in for the touchdown, and West Virginia answers back. Eighth touchdown of the season for Sean Austin.
Boy, and give Geno Smith all the credit on that drive with some of the throws that he made. His ability to escape some pressure and get out there and extend plays and then throw accurately on the run. That was an outstanding series for Geno Smith.
Tyler Bittencourt's point after, 24-21, West Virginia. Got a back and forth game going on here in Cincinnati. A good one in the Big East with 8:52 to play. Times for Dana Holgorsen will let you have an idea of how the day is going.
Now, generally, it disintegrates as the day goes on.
Going to take it out from a yard deep. Abernathy, smashed down at the 20.
That was Donovan Miles.
who's hurt,
applying that hit.
And this is a full speed whack right there. It almost looked like his helmet collided with his own teammate on that one. See Cecil level? I don't know, maybe not so much. But that is a violent hit. A full speeder. Sometimes you hit him so hard you hurt yourself.
Very physical, and Cincinnati trailing once again. Begins at their own 22-yard line. Heed up near the 25. So since the exit due to injury by Kolaris, Lego has been the quarterback, and in the last three drives, Lego has helped move them more efficiently.
They're daring him to throw the football, though. You see all these guys in the box. Even though Cincinnati's trying to spread them out by formation, they're still putting a bunch of guys in that box expecting run.
The punt came in motion. They faked the handoff to Pede. He does throw, and out of reach of Tompkins, who had a couple of white shirts around him, sandwiched in between Ian Smith and Keith Tandy.
Yeah, double coverage down there, and I believe Legault, he saw it and just threw that one away.
So a third down and 7. Bearcats 4-12 on third down. Flag.
False start. Offense, number 59. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Alex Hoffman jumping. So it's now third and 12.
Hoffman's had his hands full today. Bruce Irvin's over there working on him. And Irvin is so quick off the ball. You hardly can blame Hoffman for trying to get a head start. There's Irvin right there coming again.
Lego. Lost the football. Recovered at the 9. Najee Good. It is West Virginia football inside the Cincinnati 10.
Irvin had the initial pressure, and Najee Good is just spying on this. C-52 just sitting back there waiting for something to happen, for something to break down, and then it does break down, and he shows up. And I don't know what Munchie was doing with that football. You got to tuck that thing away at the end. He just kind of held it out in his hand and then lost it. Right here, put two hands on it, tuck it away. Knee was down before that ball came out. I think you need to, what did they rule on it? Did they call it a fumble?
I'm going to look at it again.
The previous play is under further review.
So while they take a look at this potential fumble, we'll step aside once again here in Cincinnati.
After further review, it has been determined that the runner was down prior to losing possession of the ball. I will make it fourth down from the 8-yard line. Cincinnati regained possession of the ball.
Well, our fifth review, and again, it looks like they get it right here. And Lego's knee is down before the ball comes out. Right there and
yeah, right there.
There again.
He's got the football still. The Lord only knows what he was doing with it. But right there, the knee's down. He's got the football, so upon further review, they give it back to Cincinnati.
It is fourth down, and they have to punt. Pat O'Donnell at 6 yards deep in his own end zone. Tavon Austin in his own 46. Good punt from O'Donnell. Sends Austin all the way back to his 30. Makes a cut to the outside and out of bounds at the 32. Here's an update from the studio. Once again, we check in with Robert Flores.
Mm-hmm.
Armour, thanks. That was a 61-yard punt by O'Donnell, one-yard return. Well, does have West Virginia beginning this drive at their own 32-yard line.
Yeah, Kayvon Austin lining up in the backfield here.
They hand it to him. Austin turns the corner, cuts it up to the 39-yard line. Tackled by Drew Fry.
Excuse me, Mark. Just another way to get the ball into Austin's hands. And, you know, we've seen it. We've showed it to you several times today on various ways. He gains yardage. Second in the country in all-purpose yardage, 190 per game. I don't blame him. Get that ball in his hands any way you can.
Just over 7 minutes left in this fourth quarter. Second down and four. In motion, Urban. That's up in the slot on the right side. Smith under pressure, gets rid of it to Austin. Makes a move to get to the 40. 45. What a run by Austin after the catch up to the 46.
He made Drew Fry miss twice on the same play. Here he comes. It's just a little quick flare pass to the outside. And watch right here. He misses him once. Misses him twice. That guy is just hard to tackle, man. He's amazing.
First down, Mountaineers at their own 46. Bowie now the lone back.
West Virginia milking the clock as much as they can now with the lead.
Hand off Bowie. Back down at the 47-yard line. Gain of two, Derek Wolf with the tackle. Number one, Tavon Austin, junior out of Baltimore, Maryland, went to Dunbar High School. Such an electric player.
Well, he's getting it done a lot of different ways. You see that 223 total yards on the day, averaging nearly 15 yards per touch.
Up Smith, incomplete. Ivan McCartney had it for a moment. A flag out, couple of flags.
Yeah, McCartney stepped out of bounds and then was the first one to touch it on the way back in. So this will be a penalty against West Virginia, which will probably be declined. It's an illegal
loss
touch.
Loss of down.
And the deal is, if you, and McCartney did, you go out of bounds on your own power, then you can't be the first one to touch it when you come back in.
Illegal touching. Offense, number five. Stepped out of bounds and was the first to touch a forward pass. It's a loss of down at the previous spot. Third down.
But as you say, if you're pushed out by a defender, that's okay. But if you go out on your own, you can't be the first to touch it. See, he was out with that left foot.
Ended up dropping it anyway. But.
Third down and eight. Empty backfield. Bailey met at midfield. About 5 or 6 yards shy of the first down. A tackle for Derek Wolf. So he ran a little clock, but we'll have to punt with 5.5 minutes to go in counting.
Yeah, great recognition by Wolf, who was one of the three pass rushers that Cincinnati had, but he kind of got stonewalled at the line. Saw the screen pass, turned and chased it. Another effort play by the Cincinnati defense and Derek Wolf.
Almost got there, but a short punt lands at the 24 and out of bounds inside the 20. Went out at about the 18-yard line, 32-yard punt. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. From here in Cincinnati, 3-point game. Geno Smith, he's played marvelously in this football game.
He really has. And you got to give Munchie Lego a little credit, too, for coming in and obviously not comfortable, not the number one quarterback, but yet he's been able to make enough plays to keep his team in this game and have him set up here with 5:02 left, perhaps win it.
108 yards for Pete. He came in averaging 103. Lego looking to throw on first down. We'll pull it down. And now get rid of it. Was he far enough out of the tackle box.
Yeah, no doubt about that. My question was whether or not he crossed the line of scrimmage and came back, but he did not.
It's Doug Rigg, number 47, who pressured. Zach Kolaris, who came out of the game with about 8 minutes to go in the second quarter after injuring his right lower leg. And off. Running back, wrapped up. That's Bruce Irvin, who is another Mountaineer who's had a fantastic game.
Irvin's just been incredible today. In this one, he recognizes, puts the brakes on, sees it's kind of a cutback screen, a counter draw is exactly what this is. And you see Irvin, he starts out so wide that he's able to react and see it. And because he's so wide, he puts tremendous pressure on the offensive tackles.
Third and 12, but a flag is going to make it third and 17.
5-yard penalty, third down.
Cincinnati's come from behind to win each of the last 3 weeks. They came from behind in the second half here today. West Virginia with the touchdown run by Alston, leading by three. Big third down here in 17 from their own 11 for the Bearcats.
There's Bruce Irvin right there.
Four tackles, a sack, a couple tackles for loss, and a forced fumble today, Irvin. Lego lets it go. Incomplete. And he hung on. That would have been a first down. Tandy broke it up at the last moment, intended for Anthony McClung.
Take a look at it. Here's Tandy making the break and got there right at the same time that the football did. But McClung has got to do a better job of using his body to ward off that defender and get his hands outstretched so he can make a good grab on that. His technique broke down.
Pat O'Donnell punt about his own goal line. Austin from the 40 will run left, get a block. Midfield. Turns the corner at the 40 and is out inside the 35.
Boy, if I'm going against Tavon Austin, I'm not kicking him the football, first off. And then if I am, I'm going to have double contain guys. Right here, you see, bam, there's the only contain guy, and he got knocked out of there. You got to have double contain guys because all Austin's trying to do is beat you in a foot race to the edge. And he is so fast, you need two guys out there. But I question kicking it to him.
Look like Reuben Haley. Well, nonetheless, they got a couple number 23s on that West Virginia team. And pretty good block for Austin getting up that left side. Immediately wrapped up for a loss. Up in there that time. Hughes. Now Austin to his feet.
And you're going to see West Virginia milk this clock as much as they can, try not to snap the football until there's literally no time left on the play clock.
Play clock still at 12. Snap it with 5 on the play clock. 36-yard line. Mills and Hughes with the tackle.
Yeah. Cincinnati uses their first timeout, and I was going to recommend that they do.
Now they're set. Third and 12. Austin is the back. Under heat, Smith escapes to the 30-yard line and about 5 or 6 yards shy of the first down.
Cincinnati needs to use another, timeout. I don't know why they're not.
Well, fourth down.
I don't understand this one by Butch Jones. To me, you call that timeout and save as much as you can because you never put it back on the clock. You can find ways to stop it on offense so that you don't need to carry two timeouts.
Still 10 on the play clock, and Holgorsen, who has a couple timeouts left, can wait till the play clock gets to one and then burn a timeout and get that clock down to about 2:06.
That's what he does.
Missed it. Knew that left upright along the crossbar as well, tried to sneak it in.
And there was a late little shoving match going on down there that Walter Stewart got a push on the kicker a little bit. Dana Holgorsen wanted a call on that. Right there, you see Stewart kind of bouncing into the kicker there, and that upset some people. I thought it was harmless myself.
2:01 to go. Still a three-point game, West Virginia leading. Bearcats begin at their own 30. Four receivers, three left. Lego lets it go. Complete! Tompkins to the 36. Ball seemed to hang up for a while. There is a flag down. Hold on. Flag back at the 45 of Cincinnati.
Holding. Keeping. Number six.
Against West Virginia.
Yeah, Pat Miller called for the hold, but here's the look. Right there, you see that's the hold as Tompkins got past him. But a great adjustment to the football by Kimbrell Thompson.
It's a gain of 34. First down Bearcats at the 36 of West Virginia. Heed. Forward progress may get a half yard or a yard. Julian Miller, number 97, pushed him back.
Cincinnati only needs a field goal to tie this. Obviously, they want to get the touchdown and try to get a win here, but they're trying to do this with a backup quarterback, Monchi Legault.
Legault across the middle, completed the 22, first down. That stopped the clock to move the chains. It was Kimbrell Thompkins again.
And this is where Lego is really good to me, when he's in the pocket. You see he's got the confidence, he moves well in the pocket, and when his feet are right, when his footwork is good, he can throw dimes.
Gives it up, Heed. Keeps the feet moving to the 15. A minute to go, clock running.
And what Butch Jones wants to do is make sure he does not leave enough time for Geno Smith to do anything on the backside.
Lego under heat. A battle there at the 13-yard line. It's incomplete. Marwin Cook pursued Munchie Lego. Cook, number 25.
Now that brings up the third down here. And they are in field goal range, but obviously they want seven. They want the touchdown and end this thing. 34 seconds left.
There you go. Not going to get there. Fourth down. A field goal to tie.
And you're going to see Butch Jones let this thing run down to about 3 seconds left and then use his timeout and try to kick a tying field goal on the last play of regulation and send us into overtime.
Wind can be an issue here at Paul Brown Stadium, even on a mostly clear day like today.
Yeah, we were down there on the field before the game, and the wind coming off the river, gusting pretty good, but it would be at the back pretty much of Tony Miliano.
Liano today, 0-for-1. He missed a 42-yarder.
He's had a couple of blocks. 12 of 15 on the year coming in. He's 12 of 16 now.
This would only be about a 31-yarder or thereabouts. Zach Kolaris, who had to leave the game after being injured. It's a little over 8 minutes to go in the second quarter. Lower right leg injury.
Butch Jones giving some last second instructions, and he wants another timeout. Was he icing his own kicker?
I was going to ask you.
And I don't understand why the clock ran either, because it was a timeout. The clock shouldn't run again until it's put back into play.
So 3 seconds left in regulation in this crucial Big East game. Cincinnati, the only unbeaten still in conference play. West Virginia, 2-2 in conference play. Louisville beaten today, so they're 3-2.
Yeah, Pitt knocked off Louisville today.
21-14.
So you can see Cincinnati, what this game would mean to them. A victory here today would really put them in the driver's seat. Now a loss would open it up for all those two-loss teams, and you've got a bunch of them there. Turn it into a six-team race.
To send us to overtime, Tony Miliano from 31 yards. Blocked. And West Virginia will hang on and win it on the road. ...31-yard attempt, block, and West Virginia wins it 24-21.
Wow.
The six-game winning streak for Cincinnati comes to an end.
Here it is. And that was just penetration up the middle, but that was a low kick. Looked like Broderick Jenkins was the man who blocked it. But that kick was low coming out. And all of a sudden, the Big East is wide open again.
You bet it is. No more unbeatens in conference play. Cincinnati falling for the first time. Ian Smith celebrating. And this is how the Big East looks at this moment. We have the Bearcats now at 3-1. Louisville, Rutgers, Pitt, and West Virginia all 3-2. It's going to be crazy, Ray.
Oh, I'll tell you, this one's going to go down to the wire. And give credit to Dana Holgorsen and the Mountaineers for hanging in there and getting it done today.
24-21, West Virginia wins it. Stay tuned for more college football. Michigan, Illinois, or Miami.